Daarvoor doe je het natuurlijk allemaal. 'S Ochtends om 7 uur opstaan om een Londen mee te maken dat ontwaakt. En eigenlijk is dit de beste plek om dat te doen. Want hier is Londen ook ooit begonnen. Zonder de River Thames zou je niet kunnen spreken van deze hoofdstad. Welkom, dit is Groen Londen. This is pure magic. I wouldn't have thought this to be so good. Who came up with the idea of kayaking on the River Thames?
My wife and I have been kayaking for some time. We wanted to share the magical experience of being on the water in the middle of an enormous city. Down here, it's like being a completely different landscape.
Yes.
Before the city wakes up, it's quiet, it's magical. It's a very unique way to see London.
Because you get to see it from the water.
Completely different angle.
And it is true that if it wasn't for this river, River Thames, there wouldn't be no London.
London wouldn't exist. London's unique from the point that it is a high ground around marshlands, what was originally marshlands, where the boats could come up into the river to navigate inland. And also it was narrow enough to build bridges across. So those 3 points made London develop where it is.
Okay. Dan, where are you?
I'm right behind you.
Come on! Now, let's be honest. I mean, the River Thames used to be an open sewer. Is it clean or should I worry today, Dan?
I don't think you need to worry today. In 2010, it scooped the International Theseus River Prize. It's one of the biggest environmental prizes given to river management in the world.
Okay.
The Environmental Agency, the government department, has done a lot of work over the last 50 years of cleaning it up. It has salmon, trout, otters living in it now, much, much cleaner than it was in the 50s. And now they have a super sewer planned, which will run the full length of London from West London to East London. Big enough, the pipe will be big enough to take 3 double-decker buses.
Really?
Enormous.
So you can have a lot of shit in there.
You can have a lot in there.
Well, dit is eigenlijk wel echt uniek, hè? Je zit hier op het water, maar tegelijkertijd in het hartje van Londen. En het is bijzonder rustig ook op het water. En dit is al goed. Maar pas op, het wordt nog beter.
Want iets minder dan 100 meter verder sta ik plots in de City of London. Het financiële hart waar yuppies miljoenen deals afspreken op hun veel te dure smartphones. Hoe kan ik hier in hemelsnaam Groen Londen vinden?
En toch bestaat het. Maar dat ga ik u niet bewijzen. Dat doet mijn nieuwe vriend Steve. Hi Steve.
Hallo Steve.
Oh, you're Steve. I'm Ben.
Steve, hij dus voor de duidelijkheid, verdiept zich al jaren in de groene geheime plekjes tussen het beton en metaal. Hij beweert dat ook hier groene rust te vinden is. Je moet alleen goed kijken.
Okay, well, here we are in the smallest garden in the city. And it's actually a private garden, but it's open to the public. It's occupied by a solicitor's office today in an old church. They've kept the churchyard that was here originally. This is a nice place to relax and to be peaceful. And we're protected from the traffic of the city on both sides by the buildings on either side. So it's a wonderful place.
Steve, how did you come up with the idea of showing green spots right here in the centre of the City of London?
Well, I used to work in the City of London and I discovered these for myself over a long period of time. And it's interesting to know that these are within a square mile of the City of London, which is a self-governing state. It has its own police force and it has its own Lord Mayor, completely
really?
Separate from the rest of London.
Yeah, how many small little gardens do we have then?
There are almost 200.
Okay, and you felt that you should have show people how green this really is.
Exactly. this is the very beginning of London, because we're looking at the ruins of the Roman city of Londinium. And the ruins are 15 feet underground, but there's been buildings built on top, but they were actually bombed in the Second World War.
So that's why?
So the Second World War bombing has left this exposed, and now we have this wonderful green garden with wild flowers growing on the Roman ruins of Londinium. Here we are in the east of the city, and this is the entrance to the secret garden.
This is the entrance to a garden.
What a surprise.
Wouldn't expect here to be a garden.
No. Probably the most treasured of the gardens here. It's an old churchyard, but this is a special place for me because most of Londoners don't know. Even Londoners who have worked here for, say, 20 years or 30 years, they don't know about this.
Because it's so well hidden.
And this is so well hidden, yeah. But it's an old churchyard, and there are still gravestones here. And one of the reasons for this garden to be still here is that when that man died, John Middleton, the family paid £500 in 1700 to the City of London to keep his grave in perpetuity. And the City of London kept their promise to keep his grave.
So that's going to be here forever and ever and ever and ever. So we had the most secret garden. What would you call this then?
Well, this is the most beautiful garden in the city, and it's particularly special because we're walking into the walls of the church, but the garden is in the middle of the church. The church lost its roof two times, once in the Great Fire of London and then once in the firebombing of the Second World War, Blitz. So it's a wonderful place to come and relax inside the walls of the church, protected.
Exactly. This would be the perfect place for people who work here in the neighbourhood to come and meet their own lovers or something like that.
Certainly would be a good place for that. It might be going on over your shoulder as we speak.
You're kidding. Oh, yeah.
Laat ons zeggen dat de tour met Steve een voorproevertje is van wat nog komen moet. Tijd voor het echte werk.
En iets minder verrassend dan die verborgen groene tuintjes zijn de Royal Parks of London. Zij zorgen ervoor dat Londen vandaag een van de groenste metropolen ter wereld is. In totaal 2000 hectare plantplezier. Neem even een voetbalveld, doe dat maal 4000. Voilà, zoveel dus. Hello.
Hello.
Can I ask you a question?
You can try.
Can I try? I was just wondering, do you know anything about the history of the Royal Parks in London?
Not very much, no, I'm afraid.
Don't ever mistake a Royal Park for a regular public park.
Because it's not.
But make no mistake, the public does not have any legal right to use the parks.
Basically, a royal park is what its name tells you. It's royal.
All of the royal parks used to be hunting grounds for the royal family.
Deer hunting was especially popular with the Tudors, especially hunt mad Henry VIII.
Yeah, they used to be hunting, I think.
Yeah, and deer.
Yes.
From the 17th century on, several of these parks were open to the public.
King James first allowed his courtiers to use the park, and then Charles II opened it up freely.
Today, the 8 royal parks are here for everyone to enjoy a pleasant picnic or a game of cricket.
Menos mal que la familia real está debe estar agradecida con todos los visitantes. Si no, no alcanzan ellos para cortar toda la hierba que hay en estos parques.
Dit is Britse pocherij op zijn best in Greenwich Park, gebouwd met geld uit de talrijke kolonies. Kijk naar de Queen's House, een van de cadeautjes van King James aan zijn Deense Queen Anne, die hier overigens nooit geweest is. Adel, ja, rare jongens. Maar voor ons is het vooral bekend omwille van het riante Royal Observatory. Gebouwd in opdracht van King Charles II, die met de bouw ervan hoopte op betere locatiebepalingen voor zijn schepen. Want die liepen te vaak op de klippen. Je vindt hier de befaamde Nulmeridiaan, die overigens helemaal toevallig hier ligt, want die kon evenwel in Zwevenzeelen liggen.
This is the first meridian line made by Edmund Halley. So 15 meters further east and 20 years later, this is the meridian line used by astronomer royal James Bradley.
Okay.
So we've now moved another 6 meters east and this is the prime meridian.
This is a prime meridian
for the whole world.
How does that work? I mean, there's 3 meridians within meters from each other.
Well, each astronomer royal wanted to do better than his predecessors, so he would build a new meridian line using the latest telescope technology.
It's not because they were big-headed or something.
Well, they were scientists and they thought they were quite important people. They were doing a very important job. And what they did was they used this meridian to measure when stars passed overhead as the Earth rotated. And they used it to make very, very accurate maps of the sky and to measure Greenwich Mean Time. So it defines the time for the world and also the positions and the maps for the whole world. Many other observatories around the world had their own meridian lines where they did similar work, but in 1884 it was agreed that to avoid confusion everybody would use the meridian here in Greenwich, and that's how it became the prime meridian for the whole world.
All right, brilliant.
Terug het water op. Met de Thames Clipper sta je zo opnieuw in het centrum. Let's go. Groen is ons thema en groen zal dus ook mijn volgend vervoersmiddel zijn. Niks hybride wagen, niks zonne-energie. Het wordt een fiets.
Ja, vergeet heel even de London Cab, vergeet de dubbeldekkerbussen, want sinds kort heeft Londen een nieuw icoon in transport. De Boris Bike, genoemd naar de enige echte Boris Johnson, de burgemeester, die ontzettend graag met die fietsen rijdt. Ondertussen rijden er zo'n 6000 rond sinds 2010. Maar je kan wel zeggen dat ze een beetje slachtoffer van hun eigen succes zijn geworden. Want op mooie dagen rijdt zowat elke Londenaar op een Boris Bike, waardoor er een te pakken krijgen niet al te even evident is. Goed, ik heb hier dus een code. De bedoeling is dat ik die dan ingeef. Deze werkt dus niet. Er zijn er dagelijks zo'n 100 defecten. 100 defecten, dus het is een beetje spannend, jongens. Maar we gaan er wel kozen. 2. Het is gelukt. We kunnen fietsen, hè.
Londenaars hebben een spelletje gespeeld en de verschillende transportmogelijkheden tegen elkaar afgewogen. De snelste manier om je door de stad te verplaatsen is dit hier, de Boris Bike, of een gewone fiets. Je ervaart de stad ook helemaal anders en je conditie die wordt er alleen maar beter van.
So is this like a charity run or something like that?
Breast cancer, women only.
Come on, girls, come on!
Hyde Park, Regent's Park, Kensington Gardens. Geef ze me maar allemaal. Op de fiets onder de zon is het leven hier mooi.
Bye.
Volgens het gezegde is het gras altijd groener aan de overkant. Wel, dat geldt niet voor deze plek. Dames en heren, groener dan dit wordt het niet. Ik ben op Wimbledon, de enige echte center court ter wereld waar nog een Grand Slam gespeeld wordt op gras.
Haha, memorable moment. Yeah. What's up with the electrified fence here?
The Eddie? Fence is really just to keep the foxes out.
You get foxes here?
Yeah, not to keep members out or players out, or press people.
Can I
come out here?
Wow, dit is een zeer memorabel moment. Center Court, Wimbledon.
We can go on the court.
Oh, yeah. We can actually walk on here.
We'll put the goalpost up for you later on if you like.
Then we can play actual tennis. Can I touch it?
Yeah, by all means.
Now that's a nice lawn you have here.
Yeah, there's no weed in it now, so.
Eddie, I've been told that, I mean, the tournament's just on for 2 weeks a year. Yeah. And you work on this all year long.
Yeah. But you've got to remember that though the tournament you say is only on for 2 weeks, we've got members playing on the other courts, the outside courts, all the time. But also, during those 2 weeks, we may get 60 or 70 hours play on here, which is the equivalent of about 40-odd football matches during the first. So it's a whole season football matches.
Exactly.
In 2 weeks.
Yeah. But still, right now, right here, we're standing on the most expensive piece of grass in the world.
Yeah, it's only a piece of grass.
Sorry, what would you call it?
It's just turf, it's just grass.
Just grass.
It is nothing post special.
Kom op, man. Hier speelden McEnroe en Bjorn Borg. En dat noemt hij dan gewoon gras?
Do you even play tennis yourself?
No, I never got the opportunity very much at school to play tennis. That was the problem. So, but as long as you know what the players want and what they're after, then there's no big issues.
So you know everything about it, but you don't know how to play it?
I don't know everything about it, but and I don't know how to play it. But,
Is there a situation where you bumped up into McEnroe at some time? Or?
No. I think the only memory I have is on court number two, we were playing during normal members' time. And we had four people playing on court number two. And one of them was Princess Diana. And I bumped into her one day.
Okay.
And the security guards went whooshing out like this. I said, it's all right, fellas, yeah. But I literally just walked around the corner and bumped into her. She was
walking. What does one say when bumping into Princess Diana?
Sorry.
Sorry. So did you go, oh, your highness?
No,
I'm so sorry.
Sorry.
Okay.
Left her that.
Now, I know that not everybody's able to come and see the real Wimbledon tournament, but you do get these guided tours, don't you?
Yes, we get a lot of guided tours. Work with the guys regularly, and occasionally I get to do a guided tour myself. And when you do, as I did a few weeks ago, you get mixed group of husbands and wives, and everybody was saying, how do you keep this lawn so nice? How do you do so well? So we never stop working. We always work on throughout the winter, and even in the middle of the winter we mow. And you saw the husbands go, oh no, why did he say that? And the wife saying, I told you so.
Al sinds 1877 wordt hier elk jaar het toernooi gehouden. Het oorspronkelijke Wimbledon was trouwens alleen bedoeld om wat geld in te zamelen voor de club.
No wonder poor Charlotte looks so hot and bothered, scrambling about in bushes.
In het museum zie je hoe tennis van een heerlijk tijdverdrijf voor de upper class veranderd is in serious business vandaag. Je krijgt er een overzicht van de tennisgarderobe, want voor vrouwen is de outfit op het veld namelijk heel belangrijk. Voor de mannen draait het eerder om de ballen en de raketten. Zelfs McEnroe vertelt je waarom hij destijds wakker lag van het tennisracket van aartsrivaal Bjorn Borg.
De T2000, made of steel. Man, he could hit hard with it.
Ben je maar wat geïnteresseerd in balsport of tennis of zelfs gazon, dan moet je hier naartoe.
Now, Eddie, your big pièce de résistance is coming up. Next summer, you're having and the normal tournament, Wimbledon,
yep.
And, of course, the Olympic Games.
Yeah.
What does that make you feel like?
Makes me feel proud. Makes me feel nervous at the same time. We've got 2.5 weeks between the two. So we've got 2 weeks mainly to get the grass back again. What we will do is re-sow the baselines where it's slightly worn, and any other part of the court that's worn with new seed. but the seed will be pre-germinated. In other words, it will already be growing when we sow it.
But in the end of your career as 23 years of head groundsman, this must be your big finale.
When we got the Olympics, I should have retired a couple of years ago, but the club kindly asked me to stay on. So, yes, I'm here until the last one is the Olympics.
Incredible.
It's going to be a hell of a challenge all the way around.
Dat moet je mij niet vertellen, want nog veel imposanter is de gigantische Olympische site die vandaag na 6 jaar werk zo goed als klaar is.
Wimbledon is de thuisbasis voor de tennissers tijdens de Olympische Spelen. Voor alle andere sporttakken hebben ze dit gebouwd. Een gigantisch Olympisch park. Nu, voor de Olympische Spelen van 2012 was Parijs eigenlijk favoriet. En toch heeft Londen gewonnen. Waarom? Simpelweg omdat ze de groenste Spelen aller tijden wilden organiseren. Phil, we're right here near the Olympic Park, and it's hard to think that this used to be one of the most contaminated lands in London.
Absolutely, it is. Like much of East London, it was used as an industrial site for over a century, and we wanted to clean the soil on the site. So we developed a number of techniques. We built what we called soil hospitals, which literally took the soil, cleaned it, removed much of the polluted material from it, and in so doing, we've managed to retain about 85% of the ground material on the site itself and reuse it. That takes lorries off the roads, less carbon emissions, less congestion, and of course doesn't end up in landfill elsewhere. In the longer term, sustainability is driven out by, in the park, by things like biodiversity. The park is a very biodiverse park. Ultimately, we will have 100 hectares of green space. We have a lot of wildlife installations, such as otter hawks or kingfisher walls, etc.
How many trees did you put here?
We planted about 2,000 trees in the park, 4,000 trees throughout, if you include the athlete's village. The two parts of the park partly reflect the way that we've treated the landscape. The north part focuses much around the River Lee. That's the centerpiece of the park. It's a very green park. It has large spectator lawns. The South Park is a much more horticultural park. It's very gardenesque. It's certainly the largest new urban park created in London for over a century. So it's a real investment in London's future.
Now, I'm not allowed to go in there just yet. When will it be open to the public?
So the first time the park will be open to the public will be for those ticket holders who come to the games. After games, in September, October 2012, the park gets closed. And then in summer of 2013, it gets reopened as a public park when the security fence and temporary features are removed.
So you think this adds to, you know, having one of the greenest games ever?
Absolutely. I think what's unique about this is that it is a park with the games in it. Many other games have had fantastic venues, of course, but they have not been set in a parkland setting. So in terms of an Olympic park, this is quite unique.
This is unique in a man's career, I might say. So you must be very happy as well.
I'm absolutely delighted. It's a privilege to be working on a project like this. Yeah.
Congratulations, Phil.
Thank you.
Doing a good job.
Moet ik er nog een tekening bij maken? Ik dacht het niet. Het beste bewaar ik voor het einde. Mijn grote favoriet, het wildere Hampstead Heath.
Het wordt niet groener dan dit. Ik zwem in een park in een vijver tussen de eenden. En dat allemaal in het midden van een van de dichtst bevolkte steden ter wereld. Ja, ik denk dat we ondertussen wel kunnen stellen dat Londen groener is dan ooit. En nu is het enkel nog aan ons om ervan te genieten. Hè. See you next week. Salut!
Alle tips en tricks zijn terug te vinden, zoals gewoonlijk, op 1.be/Vlaanderen Vakantieland.